Next on Unsolved Mysteries. A young woman meets a handsome and charming fitness trainer, and she is swept off her feet.
Are you sure?
But before long, she discovers he is dangerous and violent. Just hours after a wealthy businessman disappears, his wife sells all of his belongings at a garage sale. And then she takes control of his multi-million dollar estate. A college student goes missing, then his burnt out car turns up at a car wash. Was he murdered by a mysterious hitchhiker? And is it possible that this is an actual remnant of the legendary Holy Grail? If so, it may have amazing healing powers.
These are stories you won't want to miss. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries.
Las Vegas, Nevada. Amber and Brittany Albanese return to their mother's home after a weekend with their divorced father.
Mom,
they're surprised to find that their mother, Joanne, is nowhere to be found.
Mom!
Joanne was not there, which might have not been that uncommon. But when they went in her bedroom, they found her purse, and they found particular items of jewelry that Joanne only took off when she showered.
Their mother hasn't returned by the next day, so the girls report her missing. Las Vegas police detectives soon discover that Joanne's boyfriend of 5 months, John Edwards, is also missing.
When Joanne and John failed to show up at work, contact her family, that's when we figured we'd better take a little closer look at it.
For over 10 years, Joanne had not been lucky with love. So she was thrilled when she met John Edwards. He was handsome, charismatic, and very attentive. But Joanne soon found out that John Edwards was not who he seemed to be.
Joanne?
Yes?
Remember the guy I told you about? Very charming,
uh-huh.
No wife, no kids.
Uh-huh.
Well, he's back there training somebody.
A friend introduced 39-year-old Joanne to John, a fitness trainer. Soon, they were dating.
Nice to meet you, Joanne.
Joanne, like most women, thought him to be very dynamic and very interesting and attractive man.
For a while, the two seemed to be madly in love. But then, something changed. Edwards paid for nothing and was living off Joanne's earnings.
This is strawberry.
It looks like it.
You brought the wrong drink.
We shut up.
And his charming personality turned into one that was jealous, possessive, and violent.
Will you shut up?
He makes sure that he's pretty much the only person she's with. Obviously, she was with her children as well, but he takes up most of her time. He, from what we understand, even made sure that he was there when she would go to the bathroom.
On the day she disappeared, Joanne left work at 4:30 in the afternoon. She told family and friends that she planned to break up with John at dinner that night. Joanne was never heard from again. Four days later, and 250 miles away, Joanne's car was found. It was parked in a remote desert area. There was no sign of Joanne or of John.
Finding the car abandoned where it was, it pretty well confirmed our fears that we had a foul play incident here.
Police discovered a truck parked outside Joanne's home that witnesses said belonged to John. But when police checked the truck's registration,
we ran that license plate and it came back as absolutely no record, which is rather unusual. Plate doesn't go to the vehicle or to anyone in particular, so there's a problem there if somebody's trying to cover something. we started questioning whether or not John Edwards was who he claimed to be.
Hoping to find some answers, police search Edwards' house.
We began looking through some of his belongings and we found a wallet that was duct taped closed.
Bingo.
And when I opened that wallet, I found identification with the person we knew as John Edwards, but it was the name of John Addis. Alaska driver's license, a certification card from the state of Alaska saying he is certified in crime scene investigations.
Let's check it out.
We realized at that point that the person we were told was John Edwards was in fact a John Addis.
But why did John Addis go to such lengths to conceal his identity? As detectives dug into his past, they found a trail of battered women that began in the Alaskan wilderness. Addis had once been an officer with the Alaska State Troopers. He had quickly risen through the ranks to become a crime scene investigator.
John was a very intelligent man. As an investigator, John really wasn't a people person as much as some others perhaps were. But if you wanted good science at a crime scene, John Addis was the guy.
Addis and his wife, Jody, were active in the local law enforcement community.
Mother, a sandwich for Jim.
Only Jody knew the truth about John Addis.
He was very controlling. It started out by just pushes or shoving, and then it was grabbing my hair, pushing me up against the wall with his hand against my throat.
Stay away from those people. I told you not to talk to them.
After 11 years of marriage and four children, Jody finally had enough.
I decided I can't live like this anymore. So I had to make a decision. I decided I am not going to put up with this. And I jumped from the vehicle.
Addis reportedly chased her down and threw her back into the truck.
Get in the damn car!
Somehow, Jody escaped. A short time later, Jody divorced Addis. Over the next few years, Addis quit his job as a state trooper and married wives number two and number three.
I started to trace back all of his prior relationships. What I saw was an escalation in violence. He was extremely violent with his third wife, who, after just having a baby with her, he was choking her so badly that her feet were off the ground.
While Addis was married to his third wife, he kidnapped the four children from his first marriage. He was arrested and served a year in prison before being paroled. Then Addis violated his parole and disappeared. 5 years later, Addis showed up in Las Vegas. It was there that he met Joanne Albanese. By then, Addis was calling himself John Edwards. The former wife beater would soon become a killer. Joanne would be his first victim.
Our best guess was before they went to dinner, they got into a heated argument. And as a result of that argument, we firmly believe that John killed her. And once she was dead, John panicked, packed her into her own car, and ultimately disposed of the body and the car outside of Prescott, Arizona.
Three years passed. Then, only 1 mile from where her car had been abandoned, a hunter found Joanne's skeletal remains. An arrest warrant was issued for John Addis.
This is not a stupid individual. This is a homicide detective who taught crime scene investigation. He's as sharp as they come, and that's what makes him tougher to find.
John Addis won't be easy to catch, and it won't be easy to arrest. I hope I'm wrong. I hope he watches this segment and decides to do the honorable thing and give himself up.
Update. John Addis did not give himself up. He managed to stay out of sight for 11 years, until the FBI received the tip
that he was in Mexico. Addis, a Mexican woman, and their two kids were living in Chiapas, Mexico. The police closed in, but by the time they got there, Addis was gone. The woman and two children he left behind were dead, victims of carbon monoxide poisoning. A few days later, the body of an American was found in a Guatemala hotel. Fingerprints identified him as John Addis. A local coroner ruled that he had died of a heart attack. Addis was 56. The case of Joanne Albanese was officially closed. However, a detective who has worked on the case for more than a decade doesn't rule out the possibility that John Addis somehow staged his own death and has eluded authorities once again. Next, a millionaire vanishes. Was he murdered? St. Croix, the U.S. Virgin Islands. A lush tropical getaway known as the American Paradise. Jim Rice is a wealthy and successful contractor. He and his wife, Astarte, have moved here to build their dream house and live the good life. But 2 years later, their marriage is crumbling.
I just don't think it's right for a man to have to go to California to get an operation without his wife.
I've already told you I can't. I've already made plans.
Jim has to fly to San Francisco for shoulder surgery.
Plans have been made.
But he's going alone because Astarte refuses to make the trip with him. The police now believe he never made that trip at all.
And he never showed up at my house. Never called from the airport, or we just never heard from him again.
When Jim first met Astarte, he was instantly captivated. But their life together was not easy. There were business failures, separations, reconciliations, and finally, Astarte's imprisonment for fraud. Yet, despite it all, Jim remained loyal to his wife. When Astarte first met Jim, she had three grown children from a previous marriage. She was born Estabel White, but as an adult, she changed her name to Astarte after a primitive goddess of love.
She seemed to make my dad happy, and I figured he saw something in her that I didn't see. And as long as he was happy, then that was okay.
Jim and Astarte moved to Hawaii. There, they started a charter fishing business.
Here we go.
2 years later, Astarte's son, Noble, was cleaning their boat when it exploded. Noble was seriously injured but recovered. Astarte just happened to be near the dock at the time. Authorities became suspicious.
Well, there was a large debt on the yacht, and they carried insurance on the yacht. Noble indicated that he was just aboard cleaning the ship, which is kind of strange because it was like 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, a strange time to be cleaning a boat using gasoline. And the yacht caught on fire, and he said it was just purely an accident. But there was sufficient cause for the authorities back there in Hawaii to charge both Astarte and Noble with the arson of the yacht.
Astarte and Noble were charged, but their trial date was postponed. A year later, Astarte was sent to prison on another fraud charge, altering court documents. After her release, Jim and Astarte moved to St. Croix and built a dream house on an isolated bluff overlooking the Caribbean. 3 years later, Jim called his daughter and told her that he was coming to California for shoulder surgery. He never arrived.
Kathy kept trying to reach him by telephone and was totally unsuccessful for about 2 weeks. When she finally was able to reach his home in St. Croix, she talked to Astarte. And at that time, Astarte had told her that Jim had run off with a woman from Australia.
No, he went off fishing on the Great Barrier Reef in Australia.
A few days later, when she talked to Astarte, the story was that Jim had flown from St. Croix to Miami. So we had two completely different stories. And later on, Astarte denied that either of these things had occurred. So we know that right from the beginning, she lied about what had happened to Jim and how he disappeared.
Kathy hired private investigator Dennis Shirah to look into her father's disappearance. Dennis found a customs declaration form dated the day Jim was supposed to leave for California. On the form, Jim's signature appeared to have been forged.
We noted that Jim supposedly had flown on an airplane from St. Croix to Miami. And in fact, the people who actually flew on that flight were Astarte, Astarte's son Noble, and Noble's girlfriend.
Dennis also discovered that Astarte requested full control of Jim's financial estate worth $2 million. These documents were filed a week before he was scheduled to leave for California. But Astarte pretended that he had already left.
We're meeting him in Miami very shortly, and that's one of the reasons we're in kind of a rush.
Probably the key document was a power of attorney in Astarte's name. This original power of attorney was in the name of Jim's daughter, Kathy Clements. Astarte had done a cut and paste job on the document and inserted her name in its place.
I hope to see you again.
Okay. Jim would have known that his assets were beginning to be changed or taken away from him. Jim's disappearance had to happen in that 12-hour period from the time that he last spoke to Kathy to the following morning when the documents were presented to the notaries.
Hi, ladies.
Hi.
Our investigation showed that just days after Jim's disappearance, all of his personal effects, his tools, his truck, were all sold in a garage sale that was conducted at the house and sold by Astarte and Noble Davis.
How you doing? Noble Davis.
Wish you home.
A few months later, Kathy received a typewritten letter from Australia signed by Jim. His signature, again, appeared to have been forged. And there was something else.
The most important thing was the fact that the letter throughout contained the words, "I am," put together. We know that from letters which we can attribute to Astarte, that was a grammatical error that she frequently used.
Kathy Clements and Dennis Shirah are convinced that Jim Rice was murdered and that his body lies somewhere beneath the blue waters of the Caribbean. Although Astarte has never been charged, authorities still consider her a prime suspect. 5 years after Jim vanished, Astarte was arrested and convicted of fraud in connection with Jim's estate. She was serving time in a minimum security prison when she simply walked out and disappeared. Update. When this story aired, an Unsolved Mysteries viewer called police and said that Astarte was living in Spokane, Washington. Police arrested her as she left for work, and she was returned to prison to serve the remainder of her 15-year sentence. She has since been released. The disappearance of Jim Rice has never been explained. Next, a young man picks up a hitchhiker and is later found, murdered. Alaska, America's last frontier. Highway 1 is its lifeline, a road that cuts through Canada's Yukon Territory that connects Alaska to the continental United States. This would be the final road taken for 25-year-old Philip Frazier. Philip was the son of two doctors. When he left his home in Anchorage, he was headed towards Evergreen College in Washington State to take pre-med classes. Philip packed up everything he owned for the trip, including two handguns. Three days after leaving home, Philip crossed the border into Canada.
Hi, where are you coming from?
Alaska.
Alaska, where are you headed?
Washington, I'm a student.
Going to the pool.
Philip did declare that he had two firearms of his own, and at that point, our Canada Customs people seized the firearms from him, as it is illegal for Americans to enter Canada with any kind of a firearm.
The next day, a hitchhiker was dropped off at a local cafe south of the border. Cafe owner Gay Frocklage and her daughter Tina were working.
The individual that dropped him off didn't come into the cafe, just dropped him off and left. There was something wrong with him, you know, in appearance, wasn't comfortable.
I remember saying to Mom, you know, maybe he escaped from a mental institution because he was so strange.
I think we got a problem here.
Yeah, you gonna stick around?
Yeah, I think I better best not leave you alone.
I wouldn't leave her alone in the building with him, as there was nobody else there at the time. I said to Tina, well, you go ahead and take care of him and I'll just hang around. As I passed the side window, I seen a small black car pull up right to the side of the cafe. And the young man in the car proceeded to act like he was searching his car, like he had misplaced something that he needed. During this time was when another vehicle pulled up to the service station.
Tina went to pump gas for another customer. She and Philip Frazier said hello.
Is that everything?
Yeah.
When the hitchhiker finally finished eating, Gay and Tina noticed that he paid with Canadian money.
I watched the hitchhiker go out and approach Frazier.
Good. How about a ride? I'm gonna go in here yet.
You sure?
Yeah.
The car sat for a few minutes, and then he pulled ahead like he had second thoughts. The hitchhiker just ran beside him and pulled the door open, and the young man in the car proceeded to let him enter. The strange thing was, is as they left the yard, Tina made some remark about he's going to live to regret this day he picked this man up. It was like a sixth sense that this man was capable of anything.
Eight hours later, 200 miles south of the cafe, Eddie and Pauline Olson pulled over to help a stranded motorist.
Oh, wow, am I glad to see you guys. Hey, I think my car ran out of gas. I don't know what happened.
You could tell he was nervous, but I thought that he was just scared of being out here this late at night. At that point, I just said, well, I'll tow you home and we'll figure it out in the morning.
The Olsons offered to let the hitchhikers sleep in their basement for the night.
There's some blankets right there.
Okay.
Have a good sleep and we'll see you in the morning.
All right, thanks. Sleep good.
He slept downstairs in our basement, and I have about 12 or 15 guns in a gun case down there. And where he slept, the guns were just right beside him there.
How'd you sleep?
The next morning, the young man told the Olsons that both his parents were doctors in Anchorage. He said that he was on his way to college to study medicine.
And I really wanted to thank you guys.
Well, I got talking to him about his car, and he told me that if I was interested, he would sell it to me. But I said, the only way I would buy it is if you waited till Monday and we went through customs. And he said that would be too late for him, eh?
I really can't wait. I really need to get going. Is there something I can do for your hospitality?
It's okay.
The Olsons thought it odd when the hitchhiker pulled out two wallets and began to behave secretively. He gave the Olsons 20 U.S. dollars. Within an hour, the young man had fixed his broken fan belt and was on the road again. Twelve hours later, Philip's car was found at a car wash in Prince George, British Columbia.
The car was burned, almost totally gutted out due to the fire. Nothing was found in the car of any significance. In fact, none of Philip Frazier's belongings have ever been found. The parents were contacted, and there was a great deal of investigation done at that point, as Philip was considered a missing person and potentially a homicide victim.
6 weeks later, Philip's body was found 70 miles from the Olsen's home.
I felt angry, bitter. I wondered what kind of a person would destroy someone who was so idealistic and so full of life.
The Royal Canadian Mounted Police believed that the mysterious hitchhiker learned everything he could about Philip so that he could assume his identity and then kill him.
In my mind, he most definitely is a dangerous person. He's taken one life. He has the capability of taking more. And I would consider him very dangerous.
These are composite drawings of the hitchhiker based on eyewitness descriptions. He is Caucasian, about 5 feet 9 inches tall, and weighs approximately 225 pounds. He has brown hair and brown eyes. The authorities believe that the hitchhiker is familiar with Toronto and Seattle. He may be using the name Philip Innes Fraser. Among the items never recovered were Philip's birth certificate, visa, passport, and checkbook. If you have any information about Philip, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Coming up, they call him the heart attacker. So far, he's stolen over $1 million from his many, many wives. We recently profiled the case of Louis Carlucci. A smooth-talking con man, Carlucci is suspected of marrying women, a lot of women, and then stealing their money. Altogether, he took more than $1 million. He also fathered over 30 children.
The problem in this kind of a case is that victims are embarrassed. Nobody likes to admit they were taken for money. They're more reluctant to admit they were taken for love.
I now pronounce you man and wife.
But finally, one victim did come forward. The woman we'll call Barbara met Carlucci in New York, and they were married soon after. But only 6 months later, he disappeared, leaving her penniless. She decided to press charges.
When Barbara first came to us and gave us information about Carlucci, we started our investigation and began to talking to quite a few people. To speak to these women was an eye-opener for me. Carlucci doesn't just leave physical and financial wreckage behind him. It's kind of a psychological scarring that you see.
I would like to see this man get caught. He doesn't belong out in society.
Shortly after this story aired, several viewers in Tennessee identified Carlucci as a local restaurant manager they knew as Louis Serra. The next day, police arrested him at his home, where he was living with his pregnant wife. Carlucci was extradited to New York, where Barbara and several other victims brought charges against him. Carlucci pleaded not guilty and was released on a $1,000 bail. When he disappeared again, police issued a new warrant. Update. Several months after jumping bail, Carlucci was captured. Police found him living with one of his former girlfriends in Los Angeles. Carlucci was sent back to New York, where authorities charged him with grand larceny, coercion, fraud, and bigamy. He was convicted on all counts and served 4 years in prison. Our research team recently heard from a woman named LaDonna Alfano. She was just a child when her mother died in a horrific accident. LaDonna told us that she had no memories of her mother and didn't know much about her family. She was hoping that we could help her find them. Dallas, Texas. Early one December afternoon, a train left the city heading west towards Abilene.
Kids, are you ready? Come on, David, mom's
At around the same time, two Army wives, Darlene Alfano and Pinky Johnson, rounded up their kids for a trip into town.
Got your dolls?
Also, they're having a sale on pot roast. Okay,
at around 2 p.m., Pinky's car stopped in the middle of the train tracks. No one knows how or why it happened.
What's wrong? Pinky, there's a train. What's wrong?
Get it to start.
What do you mean you can't get it to start?
It won't start.
Look at the train coming.
The car was literally torn to shreds. Its roof was sliced completely off. Two of the children died immediately. A third died in the hospital. So did Darlene Alfano. Her husband, Fred, was by her side.
I was sitting with her, talking to her, and I was holding her hand. She took a very deep breath, held it for a few seconds, and very slowly let it out, and I knew she had expired.
Fred found himself almost completely alone. He had lost his wife and two of his children. His other child, LaDonna, survived, but she was barely hanging on.
They were all almost universally sure that LaDonna would not survive because her facial damage extended all the way down to the base of her brain.
Daddy.
Hi.
LaDonna had suffered severe injuries to her face and her head. But amazingly, she began to get better.
What happened to Mommy?
Mommy's an angel.
When my father told me that my mother and my sisters had died, I thought, oh, the angels had come down and gotten them. I was happy that they were angels. Well, I used to think, why did I live? Why was I the one that survived? I believe that when I was a child, that I lived for my father, that my father wouldn't have survived it.
Her strength gave me strength. And my only direction in life then was to take care of LaDonna, and make sure she survived and had a normal childhood.
Over the years, LaDonna had many reconstructive surgeries on her face. But there was one thing the operations couldn't correct: the loss of her mother.
I have no memories of my mother at all. I look at pictures of her and I try to remember something, and it's like looking at a magazine article of a woman. I have recollections of my twin and my father and my little sister. My father has told me stories about us as children with my mom, and it doesn't bring back any memories whatsoever.
LaDonna wanted to change all of that, but the only clue she had was a letter from her mother's father that she'd received when she was just 13 years old. It contained a photograph of her mother's sister, Patricia Ann Hintz.
I think finding my Aunt Pat will definitely fill my emptiness. Just being able to touch her and knowing that she was a part of my mother is the only thing that I have of my mother. And it would just knowing her and meeting her and hugging her would be really even enough for me right now.
Update. On the night we profiled this story, LaDonna finally found her Aunt Patricia and her mother's parents as well.
Hi.
A few weeks later, LaDonna was driving up to her Aunt Pat's house.
Oh, it's been good. Oh, you're just quaking. Don't cry.
I'm thank you. So do you.
It's totally changed my life.
Do you believe it?
Yeah, I believe it.
It's just finding them, then they're great people, and they're beautiful. I just feel totally, that empty hole is totally filled.
She lost her mother, I lost my sister. And it's just like, she found another mother, and I found a new sister. I just feel like we're just connected. I really do.
I know.
LaDonna's first visit with her grandparents made the reunion complete.
I can't even express it. I just really cannot express how I feel. There's just too many emotions going on here, and it's just a wonderful, wonderful feeling. It's great.
I just feel really like I'm at home.
Next, some say that water from a chalice called Venantius Cup has the miraculous power to heal. Could it be the Holy Grail, the legendary chalice that Jesus is said to have used at the Last Supper? It's called the Holy Grail, the cup which many believe Jesus Christ drank from at the Last Supper.
The cup is a unique symbol which brings God and man together. Many people regard the Holy Grail and Jesus Christ as one and the same.
It is considered the most sacred object of the Middle Ages. Some say it is a beautiful golden chalice. Others believe that this small, broken piece of olive wood is all that's left of the Holy Grail. Hundreds claim that the fragment of a cup called the Venantius Cup has healing powers. They say the water from the cup has cured them of arthritis, heart disease, blindness, leprosy, and even cancer. Does the Venantius Cup truly have the power to heal? For more than 2,000 years, every object associated with the Last Supper and the crucifixion has taken on a mystical significance, none more so than the Holy Grail.
For the historian, the Grail is legend, pure and simple, but legend is an amazing thing. It can enable people to do heroic things under the worst of circumstances. And that's why the Grail story is one of the greatest stories in the entire history of the world, and always will be.
The legend says that Joseph of Arimathea caught a few drops of Christ's blood in the Grail as Christ was being prepared for burial. Joseph was then sent to prison for allegedly stealing the body of Christ. Joseph wasn't given any food or water, but an angel kept him alive by placing a wafer in the Grail every day. Finally, Joseph escaped from prison, taking the Grail with him. He traveled to Glastonbury in the British Isles and founded the Church of the Holy Grail, where the cup remained hidden for the next 1,000 years. Over the centuries, the Grail was taken from one hiding place to another as wars broke out and churches were destroyed. Finally, in the 18th century, it ended up at the Venantius House, a mansion that was owned by an aristocratic family named the Powells. For 400 years, the Powells guarded the Grail, handing it down from one generation to the next. It became known as the Venantius Cup.
What began to transpire was that the chalice had healing properties. How they discovered this is not known, but at some point in time, the healing properties became more apparent.
For many years, very little was known about the Venantius Cup. That all changed one night in 1988.
This particular day, I was traveling to North Wales early in the morning. So I'd set a time of rising at 6 a.m. But at 4 a.m., I was awakened by a voice. The first time, it didn't register. And I heard a second time the voice say, "You will find the Holy Chalice."
Before dawn that same morning, a friend called. He suggested that the Reverend include the Venantius Cup in a coming exhibition of Christian artifacts. He told Griffiths he might learn more about the cup at the ruined abbey of Strata, Florida.
When I gave the curator the details, I was amazed to find that he was convinced of my experience, and he was more than willing to help. But he made it to understand that he was breaking a rule because he had promised the family that he would never redirect anyone to their present location.
The current owner of the cup is a member of the Powell family. She lives in seclusion, and she protects her privacy as strongly as she protects the Venantius Cup.
As the guardian of the Holy Grail, my duty to safeguard the cup at all times, to allow people to drink from it, to have water from it, and to send water to people if they're ill.
When I first set eyes on the chalice, I was a little disappointed because it was only fragmentary. Perhaps there's only a third of the original vessel left. But when I handled it, I can't describe in human language the effect it had upon me, as if I was already in paradise.
It's precisely that feeling of holiness that has led many to believe the cup has healing powers. The cup's guardian gives Reverend Griffiths water that has been poured over the cup. He pats the holy water on small prayer mats and then sends them to people who are sick and crippled. The Reverend says that in some cases the results are miraculous.
I have a regular meal with a young man who was once totally blind, and today he has perfect sight. I cite one case of a young man who had a leprous condition for 11 years, but the following day, his skin was perfectly clean from every trace of leprosy.
When Marlene Checkley found a lump in her left breast, her doctors believed it was cancer. She wore one of the prayer cloths beneath her clothes.
And then by the time I went for the mammogram, everything was clear. The lump was still there, but there was nothing cancerous. The doctors did say that the lump would still stay there, but after a week or two, the lump went, and I've had no further problems since with that.
The results and the testimonies were so amazing that I have no doubts whatsoever about the authenticity of the chalice being the Holy Grail that Jesus used at the Last Supper.
Could the Nanteus cup be the Holy Grail? The cup has not been carbon dated or scientifically tested in any way. Its guardian fears that any testing might damage it. But to those who claim they have been touched by its power, this simple wooden cup is indeed holy.